My topic today is not going to be exactly computational material design, but something that is used in computational material design, which is topology optimization. In fact, topology optimization is a very relevant topic in computational, computational mechanics, I would say. I've just recently checked one of the most important journals in our field, a general purpose journal, and I found out that most downloaded papers, 20% were related to topology optimization topics. So, however, this seems not to be the case in the complex conference, maybe due to the history of the conference and that it was born, as the name says, initially in terms of plasticity, material modeling, and so on. But it has evolved very much, and we can see many topics in the conference over the years. But not this one. I just checked the number of papers, the 400 papers that were presented here, and only three of them mentioned the word topology and topology optimization. And, well, maybe it's time to bring this topic into the topics of the conference. I'm glad and having this opportunity to bring it to here. So, before proceeding, I would like to acknowledge the contribution of my co-workers. First is Daniel Iago, who's doing his PhD in our group on this topic, and Professor Juan Carlos Canter and Dr. Oriol Lloveras Valls. We all work at the International Center for Numerical Methods in Engineering here at the Technical University of Catalonia in Barcelona. So this is a word that comes out from an exploration that we did of existing methods for topology optimization as a part of our main research on computational material design, including topology optimization, and just to try to find out if it's possible to improve them, to get new settings for this very well and deeply studied topic in computational mechanics. So this is the outline of my presentation. First, I will motivate this work. Then I'll present the setting in which we are considering our optimization, our topology optimization. Then I will present a specific method based on obtaining closed form solutions for a topology problem, for complex topology problems. Then I will show some applications to structural problems and also to thermal problems. And I will end up with some final remarks and conclusions. Well, what can topology optimization bring to, in combination with computational mechanics, to the engineering design and material design and number of fields? Well, this can be exemplified with this classical example. Imagine that we are a bridge engineer, and I want to just design a bridge that covers this distance, spanning this river. I define a topology design in which I want to insert my design, and I also define what are the loads that I want to introduce for the bridge to carry, and the points where the displacements are imposed. And then I would like to define where do I have to put a certain amount of material, not exactly all the volume of the domain, but a certain percentage, say, for instance, 5% in that case, so in order to optimize some properties of my design. So that's what I've done structural engineers for years. And but based on maybe experience and previous insights, in general, we will consider that the key issue for this is to consider what is called the characteristic function, which is a v-valued function that is defined on D on the design domain, and it takes the value 0 at points where there is no material and 1 at points where there is real material. So the locus of all points having the characteristic function equal to 1 defines the current design. And then we want to obtain the optimal one by minimization, some property or something that we want to minimize or maximize the negative in the structure. In that case, for instance, the classical one is the compliance. Minimize the compliance or maximize the stiffness of the resulting design. which is equivalent to minimize the compliance that can be also expressed in terms of the external forces times the displacement. So it's the work of the external forces in elasticity cases. We will consider elasticity cases from now on, and then the solution that involves the stresses, the elasticity properties of the structure at every point, and it's they are obtained by the equilibrium equation. So the design that I design has to fulfill the equilibrium equation in terms of the stiffness matrix, the displacement values, and external forces. And the second restriction that we have to fulfill is, for instance, the one dimension that I want to use a certain amount of material in that design. Okay, that has to be combined with an additional ingredient to produce the minimization, which is obtain a certain sensitivity of the functional in front of changes of the topology. When I just change the material at certain points, and then we have to need something which is called the sensitivity, but in topology design, many times it's called the topology derivative of this. So if we do that in using one of the available methods, what we obtain is something like that. That's the evolution of the bridge. And as we design that in terms of decreasing the volume of the material that I place there, and I decrease the volume until reaching the desired amount, and I obtain something which looks pretty much similar to what structural engineers have designed for art bridges, like this one. The difference is that to achieve this kind of sophisticated and elegant designs and so on, structural engineering has taken maybe, say, exaggerating a little, 2,000 years in the Roman bridge to get this design, and this is something that is done just automatically in 10 minutes by a stupid guy at least this computer. So that is just to motivate the fact that the topology optimization can produce some interesting results, and we can take advantage of it. So let me now present the optimization setting that we are considering. So, not being exhaustive, but I think that we have several options of how to deal with the problem of topology optimization. The first one refers to the design variable. The design variable, as I said, is the characteristic function that takes the value 1 or 0. So it's completely non-smooth. And the good news from that is that the result that we're going to obtain is just what is called the black and white result. So there is either material in black points, and there is no material, there are voids in the white points. The bad news is that being this function smooth, this poses some strong mathematical problems to use standard variational methods and minimization methods for the functional that we are considering. Well, one successful attempt that is maybe the most used approach in topological optimization is the called SIMP method, which just overcomes this problem by smoothing that characteristic function. So the characteristic function is smooth in some way, in something that then is called a pseudo-material density, ranging from 0 to 1, but now it's possible for it to take all values between 0 to 1. So the designs that we obtain are not just black and white, are black, gray, and white. And then we need to, after to combine these with some additional techniques, filtering techniques, and once we have that, the advantage is that we can now use standard variational problems, use the standard functional derivatives, like the Gateau derivatives, the directional derivatives, and follow a standard variational methods. Well, among these two options, we just choose the first one. We are going to get the solutions. We won't need filtering techniques, but we are going to face the problem of mathematical non-smoothness character of the non-smooth character of the characteristic of the design variable. The second design, the second option that we have to choose is about the design ambient. So in principle, we have a design domain in which we have some solid part, which is the design, and then some void part. We have just one material. That's what we call the embedded ambient or single material ambient. On the other hand, we did consider something that is also very quite used, which is use a bimaterial relaxed ambient, which is just, I consider, the hard material occupying a domain that we term omega plus, which is characterized by some elastic properties in terms of the Young modulus and other elastic properties. And unlike in this case, there is material, and that's very important in all the design domain, because we consider at the remaining of the domain a very soft material just by introducing a scaling factor to the elastic properties, which is used to call material contrast factor, alpha, which is very much smaller than one, but greater than zero. Inside that, for alpha small enough, we are approaching this situation. Just we have here a material which is just very low stiffness. So, but that have strong consequences in the way that we proceed after that. In the first case, when we want to evaluate the sensitivity of the functional that we want to minimize, we have to consider can modify the solid material, so we can remove material, and then look what is the difference of the functional per unit of change when we consider the original solid and one solid in which we remove one part. And that is not the same solid, because it's an elastic solid, but then there are boundary conditions, specific boundary conditions to play here. That can be done. And what we obtain that is what is called the exact topological derivative. I'll talk about that later on. But the newness that is introduced after that, and that we also considered here, is that here, in the relaxed case, we can talk about the material exchange. So we can consider what happens when one point, that this is an omega minus, the soft material, we just change it, exchange the material to a hard material, and conversely, a point that is in omega plus, the hard material, we exchange it to a soft material. The characteristic function, in that case, changes from zero to one, so we have an increment of the characteristic function equal one, and in that case, we have an increment of the characteristic function equal minus one. And this introduces a new function, which is the material exchange function, which is again a function defined all over the design domain, that which is now the union of the hard and then the soft material, and taking the value minus one or plus one. That is still an unsmooth function. Well, we take this approach. That's the choice we have done. And then the third setting we have to consider is the optimization strategy. So there are many. I'm not being exhaustive here. But let me compare or talk about two of them. One is the use the standard variational methods. I already mentioned something about that in smooth settings. Then it's possible to apply standard variational methods, maybe at the cost of having not black and white, but black, gray, and white solution. And after iterations, after a number of iterations, with attempts and solutions that has to be then filtered. The other, nowadays, maybe most used method is the level set methods, in which the real unknown is the so-called level set function, whose zero level set, the Hilbert contour, is the one defining the boundaries of the hard material and the soft material. And the evolution of this function, of this level set, is in the classical way made in terms of the so-called Hamilton-Jacobi equations, for which we have the rate of the variation, in pseudo-time, that in that case means iteration of this level set function, but on the other hand, we have to introduce here an appropriate sensitivity measure to get it, compatible with the fact that this is a smooth approach in terms of G. We are not considering this one, none of this one. We are considering a third one that we term the closed form solution. So it's possible, even working with a non-smooth session problems and doing some analytical analysis, to obtain, at least for some problems, closed form solutions for the topology, being non-smooth as a function of the topology itself. So for doing that, we consider that we have a pseudo-time that is right like the ratio of the amount of voids with respect to the amount of the design space, and we increase this amount in order to generate solutions along pseudo-time, which are close to each other, and then give some robustness to the solution method. So we obtain solutions like that, in which for different pseudo-times, that means different amount of material, we turn and obtain a number of solutions, which are local minimums constrained by the volume restriction or the time restriction, the pseudo-time restriction that we have here. I'll talk about that later on. And that's the approach that we are doing. And now it's time to talk about the topological derivative. So far, the topological derivative, which I said is the derivative that takes into account what is the change of the functional like that that you want to optimize when we just introduce some topology perturbation into the solid. That exact topological derivative is just the result of evaluating the functional for the initial domain or the final domain and the functional for the initial domain divided by the perturbation measure. And look that the difficulty here is that domains are not the same. It's not possible to map one-to-one all points of here from to there. It can be solved. It has been written hundreds of pages about that for elastic problems. And can be solved, but this involves a heavy mathematical work and some type of mathematical development. And essentially, that is material specific. So that when you change the material, for instance, from elastic isotropic to an anisotropic material, you have to derive again the topological derivative. Instead, in the setting we have chosen, the relaxed material setting, then we just define the topological, an approximation to this topological derivative that we call the relaxed topological derivative, we acronymize it RTD, which is just the change of the functional that we want to examine when we exchange material that we can do because we have material everywhere, from hard to soft or from soft to hard. And then that relaxed topological derivative that we express in that way, that relaxed topology, the topological derivative of J at the point x hat, then can be obtained in a very simple way using a standard Fréchet derivative of the functionals. So as the differentiation of this kernel function depending on the functional, on the characteristic function, times the exchange function that we have derived. So that is very easy because mathematically that is just changing from minus 1 to plus 1, so very easy to compute, and that is a standard differentiation that doesn't take into account the character of xi as being a smooth or non-smooth. So that's the approach that we take. So that's it, and now let's see how with these ingredients we can find closed form solutions for the optimization problem. So that is the setting we've chosen. We have a non-smooth characteristic function. And then we have to face the fact that we want to obtain a minimum, a condition that establishes that a certain topology is a local minimum. So that we have to state that every variations of the topology, everywhere or at some place, variation that we take with that minimum would translate in an increase of the functional. Okay, what is the optimality criterion? Well, in that case, it's very easy to define in terms of an inequality or a non-inequality, which is that the topological derivative at all points of the functional, at all points of the design domain, has to be greater than zero. Why? Because by definition, the topological derivative measures the change of the functional when we exchange the material at a certain point. So at the moment that a certain topology, any exchange, translates into an increasing value of the functional, that means that we are at least at the local minimum. So that's a sufficient condition for the optimality. And we can do something else, which is that this inequality, just by dividing that by the exchange function that I defined before, taking into account that it changes the sign, that can be expressed in that way. So that function, which we call the discrimination function, is greater than zero at all points belonging to the hard material phase, n smaller than zero to the soft material phase. Very easy, and from that, we can define what is the topology in terms of the hard material domain, for instance, as the locus of points where the determination function is greater than zero. This is not as easy because that is a nonlinear equation. So mathematically, this can be expressed that the characteristic function is the Heaviside function of the discrimination function, which in turn depend of the characteristic function. So it's the fixed point equation that can be solved iteratively whenever we are in the range of convergence of these fixed point equations. Well, so now we can just describe a very extremely simple algorithm that we call energy-based algorithm. You'll see why we could talk about energy-based, in which we just try to find the minimization, the topology that minimizes the certain functional, subject to the state equation, but essentially to the constraint that is going to vary when the pseudo-time varies from 0 to 1. So we can make the intervals of calculation as small as it's required for convergence reasons. Then we just consider the extended Lagrangian, considering the original functional plus the Lagrange multiplier multiplied by the constraint, and we apply the optimality criterion, the topology, the relaxed topological derivative of that functional, which is the sum of this plus that, then can be that has to be greater than zero at all points of omega plus, of omega. From that, we can identify very easily the discriminating function. It is written like that, which is minus the derivative of this kernel function with respect to chi minus lambda. And we call this term energy function. Sometimes that is an energy, sometimes it's not, but it has many times the dimensions of energy. So we keep the term of this chi that we call the energy function minus lambda. So the closed form solution of the method is all points in which the energy function for a certain topology are greater than the lambda, the Lagrange multiplier corresponding to this topology, define the hard material domain. So that is an algebraic equation that has to be now solved numerically. And for that, we just used an iterative algorithm that we term cutting and bisection, which is extremely simple. So at a certain iteration, when we have the certain topology, we just compute the energy. If you compute the energy term, then we know that if you plot this energy term with respect to lambda, every cut that we do at certain lambda define a topology in terms if the energy is larger than the value of lambda or smaller than the value of lambda. And then we have to choose the level of lambda by just cutting at the level level in which the constraint, the volume constraint is fulfilled. That is a very simple bisection strategy that works extremely fast and well. So once we have here, then we have to repeat the step because the equilibrium or the state equation changes the energy up till convergence is achieved. So it's extremely simple. And as we will see, general way of solving a family of problems. Okay, we have to face another problem which is appears here and also in many other methods of optimization, which is a possible ill-positiveness of the solution when we are solving that in terms of finite elements or discrete methods. If it is the mesh size lack of objectivity, in our case, that translates in that we cannot make sure that the discrimination function has no, so to speak, noise of low wavelengths, so that it changes suddenly in a certain point of the design domain from solid to void, from void to solid, and that can produce some solutions which are typically of ill-positiveness and depend on the size of the finite element that that can be a certain of these oscillations can be captured or not. So to do that, we used some techniques that are very well known too. We borrowed them from some image processing techniques, which is just Laplacian smoothing, in which, I mean, we just smooth out this this discrimination function in such a way that the maximum wavelength that we found out here is the smaller than a certain quantity that we prescribe. That is a control which is also generally aimed at optimal discrimination, topology optimization, which is the minimum solid filament width. We can prescribe that. And in fact, by solving this Laplace equation in terms of this parameter, we can discretize that and solve that, for instance, by finite element methods. We obtain a linear equation that, in which the right-hand side term is constant. It doesn't depend on the topology, so it can be built and factorized only one, and the right-hand side times is computed as many times as is desired. So finally, with that, I obtain a solution in which we are sure that no filament smaller than the prescribed value could be obtained in the solution. Okay, so let me now show how it works for a number of problems, initially for structural problems. That is what I mentioned before. I have the structural compliance as a cost function, the state equilibrium. Look that the constitutive equation, the related stresses with the strain, is now related through the elastic constitutive tensor that is written as the nominal constitutive tensor, elastic constitutive tensor of the material, times the topology, the characteristic function, to a certain power m. Look that this doesn't affect the value at the hard material because the characteristic function C is taking the value 1, exactly 1. So we are using the nominal elastic value for the hard material, but at the soft material, this being alpha to the power of m, is a very small value, and this warranties that we are dealing with a very soft material at the soft material domain. And then in terms of that, we obtain the classical equilibrium equation in terms of the stiffness matrix, the displacements, and the forces, and that's it. Then we have the volume construction, we build up the Lagrangian, and then we find the optimality condition, and finally, we obtain the energy term that looks like that. And we see that apart from this side here, this, in this case, is exactly the nominal elastic energy of the material. So the elastic energy that the material disregard is at the soft or at the hard part, hard phase, would have if he had the it had the nominal properties. And then that's corrected through this term here. And then we have the energy, and we can apply the cutting and bisection algorithm, and very rapidly and very robust, in a very robust way, we can find the solution. That's an application, for instance, to a classical benchmark, the cantilever beam. That's a beam, a three-dimensional beam, which is clamped at this size, is subject to certain uniform forces at this edge. And then we can see that the method provides this evolution as we reduce the material volume, the solid volume, then we obtain different topologies. All of them are optimal. And here we solve the problem with two different meshes, and we see that the meshes are the results are completely the same. So just overcome the problem of mesh dependence. Just as a curiosity, if we just consider, instead of considering the minimum parameter as a scalar, we consider it as a tensor, the minimum material width. Instead of, if you just consider as a tensor, and we apply the same method, we obtain the corresponding design, but if we just consider one of the directions with a value of the material length very large with respect to the two, we obtain extruded designs. So that means that the method, in fact, it determines the design in every direction, the minimum length, the minimum width in every direction of the solution. Another typical problem of in a structural optimization is the compliant mechanism. Maybe you know some of these examples, but it's quite interesting. In the fact, that is the design domain. We want to design a gripper, so to grasp a certain object with a certain elasticity, and then we define only where the material is going to be subjected, where is the force to be applied, the prescribed amount of force, and we define also the jaws of the gripper. And then we want to maximize the closest jaw of this gripper. And We just have to define the appropriate cost function, which is done by defining these pseudo-vertical forces that apply at the, they are not real forces, but pseudo-forces, and the product of these vertical forces times the displacements, change of sign provide the jaw closure that we want to maximize or minimize minus. So for that, after that, and that very simple operations, we obtain the energy. The energy in the same format that we saw before, in which the only difference is now we have two systems using the so-called adjoint problem method for solving the topological sensitivity. And then we have the strains involved, the strains of the original system with the real forces, half of the domain, and the strain of the pseudo forces applied to that. Well, in terms of that, we have this, and we can apply again the same method I said before in terms of cutting and bisection of the energy function. And that's the result we have. That is a more interesting structural result for several reasons. First, because, you know, the evolution of the functional is not uniform as it was before, but it presents a minimum that corresponds to a change of topology, and that corresponds to the global optimum. So in that case, we can say that among all these designs, which are all feasible designs, the minimum one is that one. Okay, is this one. And you can see that this solution, in terms of the deformation that we get, that's the design we have here, so we apply forces here, and then if we look at the deformation of that, we see that the deformation or the optimal design is able to create hinges-like points, very thin points, in such a way that the deformation is just like a rigid motion of these four parts in terms of the rotations in terms of these hinges, which is quite interesting how we can achieve such a, so to speak, clever design. Okay? And then I would like to show the application that to that of thermal problems, another field. The method is exactly the same. What changes is the state problem, the mathematical description of the problem. In that case, we have a thermal steady-state heat conduction problem. We have some region, some boundary in which you have the temperature prescribed. We have the heat conduction, normal heat conduction flux prescribed. We have also have considered ambient interaction in terms of a convection of the temperature from at this site here. We consider the mathematical problem in terms of the heat flux, that is the surface function, that is the Fourier law. Again, look that the material parameter here is expressed as, again, the same way than before, the characteristic function at the power of m times the grain of temperature, such a way that for the material, the omega plus domain, so the high conductive material, we have just the nominal value of k, but for the other parts, when we have chi is much smaller than one, then we have very low values of the conductivity, then we impose the boundary conditions, and then from that we just operate in the same way, and we can produce some interesting designs that are not that trivial. For instance, one that is the, I'm going to present is the cloaking of the thermal flux. Imagine that we have a domain that we term the ambient domain, in which you have one surface that is prescribed temperature, higher temperature, and the other surface which is lower temperature. And then we know that if the other boundaries are adiabatic, then we have, if that is the length separating these two surfaces, the resulting solution for the heat flux is a constant heat flux horizontal in terms of the conductivity, the increment of temperatures, and the distance. Okay. Imagine that we have a device that is able to determine what is happening inside this domain in terms of its perception of the heat flux at the external surface, external part of the domain. And then imagine that we want to introduce in here some object that we want to cloak, so that this device is as much as possible unable to detect it. So if we don't do anything, the introduction of this material in this ambient domain largely distorts the flux. It's no longer horizontal, it's no longer, it's distorted. But now we can also incorporate here a device clock, a cloaking device, which is made of, defines the design domain, in which we will combine high conduction material and an insulation and low conduction material in such a way that we want that the goal is that outside this perturbed zone, the flux, the heat flux and the temperature, the isothermal lines are as possible, as much as possible, the same that you were in the original problem, so that this device cannot detect them. So what we have to do is just to establish a very simple cost function, which is the difference of the perturbed flux minus the goal, the target flux, in terms of an L2 norm, so and subject to the restrictions of volume that we want to obtain. Okay, so the problem is then this, the minimization of this functional, then we have the heat conduction equation, the minimization, and then applying again the topological derivative of this function, the relaxed topological derivative of this function, which then we can identify immediately the energy term. Again, is made in that case in terms of several terms. One term is the normal, the nominal thermal energy density. Another term comes from the heat source conduction, and that comes from the joint problem. But anyway, we can also always identify an energy term and apply the corresponding cutting and algorithm that I've mentioned before, cutting and bisection algorithm. So that is the results that we obtain. Look, here we have the 3D domain. That is that is a higher surface, a higher temperature surface, the lower temperature surface. We have inside some green here object, which is not an spherical object in order to break all possible symmetries. It's just slightly elliptical with the principal axis of the ellipsoid inclined. And then we want to cloak this object by a certain devised cloaking mechanism, a device such that it's as most as possible undetectable from a thermal detecting device. Okay, so these are the results. Here we can see the evolution of the low conduction, the insulating material in the design domain, which is that. We see that it's quite complex, the morphology of this, and that as we advance, the isothermal lines become more and more outside this domain, become more and more as they were in the unperturbed case. And that is the case for the high conduction material, which is just decreasing along the design, and we obtain something. That's the final design. So the cloaking device is made of this combination of high conductive material into an insulating material ambient. It's not symmetrical, it's not trivial, but the result is pretty much, at least theoretically, what we were looking for. So we see the evolution of the problems according to the design. That's a cross section, but anyway, we can see that that's the cross section of the cloaking device. We see that it's not trivial obtaining that. The flux is manipulated in a quite complex manner, the heat flux inside this. But outside, we see that apparently there is no change with respect to the original homogeneous non-perturbed domain. Okay, some also other considerations about the computational cost. If we just compare in the examples we have considered here, in general, I mean, I'm not giving exact numbers, but the method is much cheaper than the alternative that we have considered, which is the level set method. For instance, for structural mean structural compliance problems, the solutions are the same, but the computational cost is six times faster, or the method is six times faster, and for thermal problems is about 20 times faster. That's something that we are exploring. What are the possible advantages of this methodology in front of existing methods? And I would like now to just go to some concluding remarks. We have shown that even the non-smooth topology optimization problem can be solved in a closed-form solution using a modified method in which we define the relaxed topological derivative, in which we define an optimality criterion which is based on the positive evolution or positive value of the relaxed topological derivative of the functional. In terms of accuracy, as far as we have checked now, is as good as the alternative methods. And what is better, and much better, is in terms of the computational cost. Anyway, I think that there is something that has to be explored, which is that this setting involving very non-complex differentiation or derivation of the relaxed topological derivative are going to be very suitable for extending the classical elastic topological design methods to inelastic, in terms of material, inelastic topological design methods. That's something that would be our next step to explore. And I would like just to finish with some additional information. Those of you who are interested in this method, you can just check a recently published paper in computer methods in applied mechanical engineering. And even in this conference, tomorrow, at this session at 11:30 in Rue Marona, in this session, Daniel Iago is going to present some specificities of the method when dealing with thermal topology optimization. And I will stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.